This is Babbitt Babbage, and this is what they call asynchronous, a complement to the discussion of Gadamer and Adorno, and one is going to begin, I really don't know what's behind me, one is going to begin with a reference to Adorno, followed by a little bit of a more detailed discussion, that'll be in a second video, and then a third specifically on Gadamer. And so with that, I'm going to try and share a screen here just to start. And I want to proceed then by talking about that just prelude to the discussion of Adorno aesthetic theory before getting in to the book itself. So just some general remarks as a prelude. And there we see, we mentioned this and showed this in class, but it's relevant here, Adorno in Frankfurt, and this is truly glorious, especially as an image of what is perhaps not, wouldn't have been perhaps, maybe not one of his favorite buildings, and of course a more traditional, which one would imagine, but one would miss the point, I think, in making such a claim. The introduction then, which we're going to be talking about here, is specifically parataxes, as he says, and constellations. Theodor Adorno is one of the most reviled, and esoterically speaking, this is almost the same as one can also say, one of the most revered figures in philosophy, associated as he is with reactionary views. You see him playing music here and having too many books, which he has read, terrible thing, on music, as he's said to have had, but most famously jazz. And at the same time, Adorno, we see Frankfurter Schule here. This is a program, wonderful program, faded, you can barely read it, the Frankfurt School. And Adorno was one of the founding thinkers of critical theory. As with many important figures, it can be the case that we know his name, and maybe we know some of the things he may have said, very often out of specific context, and we can lack overall familiarity with his work, and it's hard to remedy that because reading him can be off-putting. This is maybe especially so in Adorno's case. A prolific writer as he was, he wrote a lot of things on a lot of topics. And as in the case of Nietzsche, what makes things difficult again is that accessibility question, because that's the issue of Adorno's specific style, which complicates matters. It doesn't help that mainstream philosophy, that's analytic philosophy, prefers a certain simplicity and a monotone. And if one seeks this, and we do, especially in an author who writes in German, especially Adorno's German, one will face a number of challenges. Add to this the complexity of Adorno's Minima Moralia, Reflexionen aus dem beschädigten Leben, Minimum Morale, Reflections from a damaged life, but also the theoretical incisiveness of negative dialectics, along with Adorno's writings on music, where he was exceptionally prolific and exceptionally elegant, and one has a formidable thinker. Add philosophical aesthetics to the mix, and one cannot but say, as I said in our live or synchronous meeting, that Adorno is an indispensable thinker. You need him for thinking aesthetics. This is not only because Adorno, was an important correspondent, literally and figuratively, of Walter Benjamin's, taking his friend's work on aura and on history seriously and critically, and we see that in his discussion, but because of Adorno's influential, with Max Horkheim, dialectic of enlightenment, Dialektik der Aufklärung, and of course, importantly, entitled Philosophische Fragmente, philosophical fragments we see also here in the English. But there's more than that. There's also Adorno's reflection on cultural theory, explicit in the notion he developed along with Horkheimer, we see it here, of the culture industry, and the focus on the art industry is unrelenting in Adorno's critique of film, radio, but also what he names the illustrated magazines. He's against all of these mediatic forms. And we have these to this day. That would be, here's a Utkin's discussion of Adorno on popular culture, as we see, and Cosmopolitan, as it would have been at that time. And Adorno also was on the cover of Text plus Critique, very nice magazine, philosophical journal. But We're not talking about these. We're talking people. We're talking the National Enquirer, Bildzeitung, The Sun, and so on. Although that is less these days accessed through magazines and such like, but through clickbait, which is part of the argument that Guy Debord makes and illustrates. This is Donald Cuspit's appropriation of the same conundrum and problem in Debord's Society of the Spectacle, as we shall see, I hope, on Monday. Here's Marcuse, and of course, one can say Barthe, but there is really also, this one is the one that we care most about, and that is Adorno. We will, I hope, in what follows, also see a bit of the influence that Adorno had on Gadamer's, that's our big screen here, otherwise utterly differently minded essay, The Relevance of the Beautiful. He didn't write it in 77, he wrote it, as one needs to say, and this has to be corrected, in 1974. But that's a different essay where we can see that. Here, it's also useful to emphasize Adorno's influence on Derrida's understanding of Husserl via Adorno's 1956 Against Epistemology. And it's important to underline, as a kind of reverse auratic, Adorno's unrelentingly critical and shadow engagement with Heidegger. Much more subtle, to be sure, and we see that throughout the text, is Adorno's insightful and positive reading of Nietzsche. And we mentioned that several loci in Aesthetische Theorie. When it comes to Adorno's aesthetic theory, here we have the most recent title cover. This is also another that's available, the same text, same translation. We've to do with the equivalent of a bit more than a simple editorial project, as Heidegger warned us against these products, because, as Heidegger says, these work backwards on the works produced in the thinker's lifetime, and so change works the thinker intended. And we noted when we went over Hegel Aesthetik, that this was compiled by H.G. Hotho at Hotho's discretion. And where original texts don't stand at our disposition, we have Hotho's word for it. In the case of the still more egregious, because it does get more egregious, editorial intervention, that was Elizabeth Förster Nietzsche. There we see her there. We also see her a bit younger there, along with, to be sure, a shifting cast of editing editors who did the heavy editorial lifting in each case, including Rudolf Steiner among them, producing The Will to Power in successive editions of successively increasing size. The compilation can be gathered of fragments and augmented with further drafts. And in the case of Adorno's aesthetic theory, that is still ongoing. There's always something for a later team of scholars to do. Adorno's aesthetic theory, such as we have it, and I'm going to stay with this question of Kierkegaard, is largely his own draft, but not entirely. The introduction is so very provisional that the editors put it on to the end, entitled it as such, provisional, so not draft introduction. And it was, that to be, is important to say, a work of late productivity. And at the beginning of Adorno's active life, we can see here, we have been looking at his Habilitationsschrift on Kierkegaard. And of course, we see here Construction of the Aesthetic, that was in the title, which he published wunderkind-like. He was 30 when he did so in 1933. But also, just to keep to aesthetics and reflecting his sojourn in California, which was a serious influence, with Hans Eisler, composing for the films in 1947, and thus published in English. A factively how-to book for and about composers entitled For the Films. In German, you have Komposition für den Film. One should remember, of course, that Hollywood or the entertainment industry is still the prime locus for employment for composers who are technically trained writing music to this day. He also published the important and elusive Philosophy of New Music in German in 1949. And in 1952, we have the English version here, a book attempt or essay, which was translated in 1981 as In Search of Wagner. Then a book in 1956 entitled Dissonanzen, Musik in der verwalteten Welt. The beautifully titled Klangfiguren, which would be one of the first collection of musical writings, later translated as Sound Figures, and then a year later, A Musical Physiognomy on Gustav Mahler. And a series of 12 lectures in 62, introducing the sociology of music as a follow-up in 63 to the Klangfiguren, and even more beautifully given its content, very paratactically so, to the point of sweetness, the quasi una fantasia, which you see here. Adorno brought out a collection of all his essays on music in 1964, translated by Wieland Horban in 2009 in Midnight Music, interrupted in 1965 by what has to be the most famous work of Adorno's among Anglophone philosophers who are interested in using Adorno as a kind of pit bull against Heidegger and who otherwise know nothing of him, the jargon of authenticity. Most people stop at the title. Prejudices neatly confirmed, and don't imagine they need to proceed any further or do anything like read it. The German jargon, der Eigentlichkeit, includes an important subtitle, zur deutschen Ideologie, that disappears in the 1973 English translation. What follows in 1967, gloriously here, somewhat in the spirit of minima moralia for aesthetics is own Leitbild, Parva Aesthetica, along with, seemingly in the same mode, a book on Alpenberg as master of the tiniest transitions, translated as master of the smallest link. This doesn't have a subtitle here, but it is a glorious cover. Finally, Impromptus, zweite Folge, neu gedruckt, musikalische Aussätze, and there we are at an end. I've not mentioned Adorno's books on literature and additional reflections on critical and political themes, or his writings on Kant and Hegel. Adorno himself saw this aesthetische Theorie as a work through several drafts, reflecting on the limitations of his efforts. For example, as the editors, his wife, Gretel Adorno, and Rolf Tiedemann tell us when they cite him with respect to the second draft, just where Adorno seems to set the same demands on his book that he otherwise places on the work of art. The book, he says, must, so to speak, be written in equally weighted paratactical parts that are arranged around a midpoint that they express through their constellation. It's an intriguing desideratum, if one can think of it that way, and I think we should. Of course, what Adorno would have meant by that is challenging, beginning with the notion, we can almost find it in the center there, of the paratactic. The editor's solution for their part, Gretel Adorno and Tiedemann, is to include everything towards the end of featuring the complete text as they wrote of the final version. But that's a bit inaccurate, as a kind of kitchen sink, you could say, is also included under the title of the Paralipomena. Tacked in as such, towards the end of the chapters of the book, one can lose the sense of Adorno's appreciation of and for Schopenhauer's aesthetic, which also, of course, let us not forget, includes music. In addition, in presenting, quote unquote, the complete text, which is what the editors call it, Gretel Adorno and Rolf Tiedemann, one isn't to imagine that one encounters anything like what Adorno writes as the order of parts arranged around a midpoint, paratactic or otherwise, as the order followed the sensibility of the editors perforce, and just because the book not being finished, it also was not arranged. This is once more fatal, and nothing can be done about this, such as finitude, and more forgiving than it might be in the case of another author. The style of Adorno's expression in these chapters finds its illustration in razor-sharp observations on art that turn reflexively on themselves, as paratactically as one likes, bringing out very often what's not said by way of what is said. Adorno would seem to have achieved what Nietzsche thought essential to style, that is to say things in a sentence that others don't say in a book. And in this case, it can be valuable to read the sentences in context, that is, for the sake of their constellation. And while one need not or doesn't have to become an Adornian or even an Adorno scholar, one can see from the side of the artists, as it were, especially from the side of the musicians, why Charles Rosen in 2002, he has an essay here on Adorno, could stir up a hornet's nest among musicologists and philosophers of music, where he asked, should we adore Adorno? And the answer is adoring Adorno in reply. Indeed, that hornet's nest was, of 2002, still buzzing 10 years later in London at the Royal Musical Association Music and Philosophy Study Group when Roger Scruton, here we see him here, pronounced Adorno in the same journalistic headline-worthy style that is sometimes characteristic of analytic philosophy. And late Sir Roger Scruton was an analytic philosopher. His analytic philosopher, is Adorno a dead duck? I took this photograph of him just after he gave that lecture in 2012. Adorno, for his part, writes nomically, consummately, in Fortune Cookies. And I cannot possibly go through these here. The book itself deserves a paratactic reading, tracing each point through its background, its context, those against whom it is directed, those for whom it's written, all for the sake of aesthetic theory, philosophical aesthetic as such. Judgment, let it be Kant, the schematism, that's the first critique. Subject and object, also first and third critique. Situation, that's specifically the language of the Frankfurt School, and so on, quite in order to understand the work of art, the question of origin, and indeed, the question of art. And for the sake of next week, for the purpose of reading Baudrillard, and Debord, Jean Baudrillard, and Guy Debord. Adorno and Horkheimer, the culture, industry, enlightenment as mass deception. And it should be noted that Adorno himself includes that 1963, the culture industry revisited in On a Light Bild. To this extent, much of our language of mass culture as we understand it today is indebted to this and can be illuminated by it.